welcome to St. Edmundsbury Cathedral for tonight's service of Compline, or night prayer, at the start of Holy Week. You'll know that during Lent we've been exploring Professor David Ford's exploration of John's Gospel, and our speakers each evening, Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday, will explore the characters in John's Gospel: the beloved disciple, the person of Mary, and tonight Canon Michael will speak about the person of Lazarus. You'll be able to follow the words of the service in the purple coloured booklets. Please do join in with the words printed in bold. The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and a perfect end.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. Asking God's mercy and peace for us and for his world, so together we pray. Most merciful God, we confess to you before the whole company of heaven and one another that we have sinned in thought, word and deed, and in what we have failed to do. Forgive us our sins, heal us by your Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ. Amen. May the Almighty and most merciful Lord grant unto us pardon, absolution and remission for all our sins, and bring us to everlasting life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Now and shall be forever. Amen.
A reading from John chapter 11, starting at verse 17. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know the Lord will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called to her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews were with her in the house consoling her and saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came to her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, see how he loved him? But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead for 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you, if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew you would always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and his feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Here ends the lesson.
Cheer, Jesus, our soul. May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. If I could meet any character from the Bible, aside from Jesus, of course, I think for me it would probably be Lazarus. I think St. Paul would be too intense for me, and he seems quite moody at times. St. Peter would be a lot of fun, but as we all know, St. Peter gets things wrong. I wouldn't know what to say in the presence of the apostle to the apostles, the fearless Mary Magdalene. And like all good Catholic Anglicans, I already speak regularly with Mary, the Mother of God, anyway. But there has always been something about Lazarus that has intrigued me and moves me. He is one of the people that the Gospel of John draws out of the life of Jesus that makes me sit up and pay attention. The death and rising of Lazarus is a pivotal point in the life of Jesus as told by John. It is, of course, literally the center point, slap bang in the middle of the text, something that should not be overlooked in a gospel that is known as the literary gospel, with many layers of meaning. The raising of Lazarus is the final sign that Jesus performs before he enters Jerusalem to go and fulfill his mission on the cross. But also, it is from here, from the episode with Lazarus, that time in John's Gospel begins to slow down. The story of Jesus so far has begun with the eternal Word breaking into time and space. And the story of Jesus is told over a long time frame. But from this point, time slows down as the person of Jesus is brought into focus. It is somehow John's way of saying, pay attention. But for someone who plays such a pivotal role in the unfolding story of Jesus, we don't really know much about Lazarus. In fact, most people just remember him as the guy that Jesus brought back from the dead, and possibly the one that inspired one of the best lines in the King James Version of the Bible, "He stinketh." But we miss so much of the very deep and profound relationship between Lazarus and Jesus if all we remember of him is that he died, stank to high heaven, and came back to life. To find out a bit more about Lazarus, we need to look a little closer. For one thing, Lazarus is the first person described as a friend of Jesus. Only later in the story are the apostles told by Jesus that he no longer calls them servants, but friends. Lazarus has this first. For another, he is also the first to be called the one whom Jesus loves. Lord, he whom you love is ill, we are told at the very beginning of the Lazarus episode. And just think, when Jesus is carrying the cross and meets a group of women, often called the women of Jerusalem, he says to them, "Do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children." And yet, Jesus himself weeps for this man Lazarus. Not only that, we are told Jesus is greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. But this modern translation doesn't do justice to the emotional intensity here. The Greek word John uses tries to convey a sense of groaning and of anguish. The same word John uses can also be used in Greek to describe a horse snorting. No single person in the Gospel of John provokes such intensity and feeling from Jesus. Again, I think it's John's way of saying, pay attention. But if we look further still, we notice two very interesting things about Lazarus that are often overlooked. Firstly, he is a single man who lives at home with two unmarried sisters. For a society that is steeped deeply in patriarchy, I find it really interesting that this place where everything happens is described not as the village of Lazarus, but as the village of his sisters, Mary and Martha. Secondly, Lazarus never speaks. There seems to be a balance of power here that is tipped away from Lazarus, pointing towards him being a person of little significance. And so there is something about Lazarus' circumstances that has led some to suggest that he was possibly somebody living with a serious disability. For those who are prepared to be drawn deeper and deeper into the story of Lazarus, these small but crucial points of information are John's way of saying for a third time, pay attention to what is happening here. Pay attention. We don't know for certain whether it is true that Lazarus was someone who lived with a serious disability. But I, for one, think there is enough to make this a reasonable proposition. And I find it deeply moving. The one person who is described as the first friend of Jesus, well before any other. The one person who is described as being loved by Jesus before any other. The one for whom he weeps and groans, and the first one to experience a life after death is someone who would be described by this world as being disabled. But not so with Jesus. The most disempowered person in the whole scene is brought to the very center as all eyes look upon his tomb, and Jesus calls out his name, Lazarus, and implores him, come out. Come out and live. The eternal Word, who was in the beginning, saves his last and greatest sign before his own death and resurrection for a man that would be described today as non-verbal. So if I were to meet Lazarus, I'm not sure I'd be able to ask him the deep theological questions that I might have of St. Paul or St. Peter. I'd simply have to sit and look upon the person whose whole being was filled with new life, knowing that the sound of each single breath that he takes would be greater testimony to the love of God than any sermon I could dare to ever preach. Brothers and sisters, as we draw closer to the events of this most holy week, let us take Lazarus as our guide. Let us lay before God at the foot of the cross our weaknesses and our vulnerabilities, and let us pay attention to the work of God, who turns our greatest weaknesses into the greatest of strengths, so that we, like Lazarus, might hear our names called out of the darkness into the new life of Christ. Amen.
And shall be forever. Help us to see and know your love for us, so that in humility, love, and joy, we may place at his feet all that we have and all that we are. Through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen.
Abide with us, Lord Jesus. As the night watch looks for the morning,
so do we look for you, O Christ.
Come with the dawning of the day,
and make yourself known in the breaking of the bread.
Christ crucified, draw you to himself to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
May God bless us, that in us may be found love and humility, obedience and thanksgiving, discipline, gentleness, and peace.